just today that I learned that Sirmaur is the crown, and I think I am Sirmaur means the crown of I am. So I'm happy to be here, and I do want to take you on a flight, and this is a flight of reality. This flight of reality is on the back of a bird called artificial intelligence. The bird is real. It might have been imagination some time back, but today it is real. And on this bird, I want you to view the world with me in a different perspective. And like I said, it's all real and it's all happening right now. But I also want to take you on this bird and land on a new piece of land, which is different, which is the future. And this will be one perspective, but I want to give you this one perspective because I think it's important. It's important because the way we are going forward is not the way we can sustain this planet. So that would be the theme of what I'm going to talk about. What is artificial intelligence? What can it do? What can it not do? But more importantly, what is the future of work? And what can you do about it? So before we dive deep into AI, we must understand human intelligence, right? Yeah, so all of you would have heard IQ, and all of us are born with IQ, and much of it is inherited. All of you will agree that if you don't use what you're born with, you're going to lose it. Right? It's the same with IQ. And most of us use it, grow it, and we understand it. EQ, emotional quotient, also many of you would have heard. And many of you would have even understood the fact that those with a very high IQ do not necessarily have a high EQ. And you will come across those people throughout your career. But this is a topic which is understood, emotional quotient. The other two you might not have heard, like the hand quotient. Right? It's something which I strongly believe in, that if you use your hands to do whatever it is, if you're sculpting, if you're painting, if you're building a machine, whatever it is that you're doing, if you use your hands, you open up new neural pathways which are available to you to do any task. Right? And these are pathways which are important to you, and that's what I call as hand quotient. BQ you definitely would not have heard, because even I am cooking it up right now. So BQ is bacterial quotient, and we are only now understanding the importance of bacteria which live on us. We are not one life form. We are an ecosystem of life forms. We are a multitude of life forms, and these life forms are not harmful to us. They're good for us. So there is a host of bacteria that we have in our gut. There is a host of bacteria that we have on our skin. There is a host of bacteria that is there in every cavity that we can think of. And it's not gross. These bacteria actually help us think better, live better. So if the bacteria, the colony of bacteria, are not the right kind of bacteria, we get into depression, we get into anxiety. So it is not just the physical well-being, it is also the mental well-being. And this is the bacterial portion. And we have all these working for us, and this we are only beginning to understand. And when we talk about artificial intelligence, it is a small piece of human intelligence that we have understood, and we are trying to implement it mathematically. So what do we understand? We understand the nervous system to some extent, right? So the nervous system is made up of a simple computational unit called the neuron. Biologically, what it does, it aggregates input and passes it on to the next neuron. So computationally, the way we mimic it, we say that it does the same. It aggregates the inputs, passes it through a nonlinearity, and passes it on to the next set of neurons. So the power of the neuron biologically or mathematically doesn't come from the neuron itself. It comes from its massive interconnectivity. So what is it that it is doing? If you look at this equation, what the neuron does is there in the pink circle, but really it is the equation of a line. So if you look at the layer of the neural network, it is drawing lines in multidimensional space. So if I need to separate out cats and dogs, I can, by plotting two dimensions of the animal. So I can plot the length of the animal maybe, and I can plot the pitch of its bark or the voice of the cat, and use a neural network to separate out cats and dogs using lines. But life is not so simple. So if it is more complicated, what do I do? I take one more layer, and the lines combine to form surfaces. Surfaces in multidimensional space again. So now what can I do? I can draw more n dimensional vectors and say how do I separate out these categories in multidimensional space, and that's what the neural network does well. And in fact, it can do it much better than any human can do, because it can deal with vast amounts of data, which we cannot, and it can deal with n-dimensional spaces, which we cannot either. So that is exactly what we are seeing when people are hyping neural networks and also getting afraid of neural networks. Would you be afraid of lines and surfaces?
No.
No, so there's nothing to be afraid of a neural network. It draws lines and surfaces, and it helps you make decisions because it can separate out things which need to be decided upon, right? So that is what we are talking about. Now, in the recent few years, a lot of things have happened which make the neural networks more powerful, only from a standpoint that it's a better technological tool to practically and usefully help us. So what is it? Previously, by the way, 1990 onwards, I've been using neural networks, so it's not new. So previously, when we were using neural networks to give an image, I couldn't give an image, we didn't have the computational power. So we would take something called discrete cosine transform. Very simply put, it's 10 numbers, let's say, which represent the entire image. And I'll give that to the neural network and say, okay, make your decision. Is this a peacock or is this some other animal? Make that decision. Right? And that decision would be based on 10 numbers rather than the whole image, because computationally, I couldn't afford to do better. But then today, you don't have to do it. You throw the image, you throw the video at the neural network. It figures out its own features. So discrete cosine transform gives me features, 10 features. It will figure out its own features. It will expand the feature set instead of contracting it. And it will make the classifications that you train it to do. If you train it to do peacocks versus cats and dogs, it will do that. But if you want to train it to do something more powerful, it will do that. So that is a deep neural network. So that's one of the reasons why neural networks are talked about more today. What is the reason? The computational power allows you to do different things, and you can also bring in new algorithms because the computer will allow you to do that. So applications are many. With AI, you can do a lot of things. But the three things which you have seen most are the fact that you can do natural language processing, right? You can do voice commands. You can do voice recognition, which I talked about, image recognition. So all your Facebook friends are tagged, and immediately you can create a collection of photographs of a particular friend. So these are all things which has been done over the last 3-4 years because of neural networks. But what is next and coming is video streaming, game streaming, visual effects, all of that which can be done using neural networks. So powerful things which will make our lives easier. So that's what I want to talk to you about next. Work which we have done, work which I have done with my team and our own hands. So here's an example of what today's neural network can do. This is my team, by the way, small team, great team to work with. So what we did here is very simple. We gave an index image, only one image of my colleague Snigdha, to the training neural network. And with that, anytime I see Snigdha, I can recognize it forever. Right, and by the way, the image which I have given as an index image is a side profile without glasses, much younger. But today, I have recognized her with glasses, front facing, and smiling because she is working for us. Right? So you can see that in a team picture, everybody has been classified. And it can do it powerfully on video because the video is a collection of frames. So that is what you will see when you see a security agency using it, a shop using it, or whoever using it. You can use it on your home camera as well. How does it happen? It happens because there is one, a database of 3 million faces which you can use to train your neural network. There are publicly available codes which you can use to train your neural network. But most importantly, there is even a pre-trained neural network. Just take that neural network and provide the index image. You get a vector at the output and start using that vector to recognize Snigdha forever. Right? So the life has become, for a developer, has become easier because of this, that there is so much collaboration happening openly and publicly. Yeah, you can see the video playing, and what you see on the left is a low resolution, smaller image, a video, and it is being sent through the bandwidth, which you don't need very high bandwidth for, but at the edge, we are able to scale it up in resolution, removing the noise, as well as we can increase the dynamic range, we can introduce a video X-ray, and we can create a recommendation engine. How about that? Why is it important? Number one, I can reduce the carbon footprint significantly. I can bring it down for the same experience, I can bring it down by 40%. Only number two, I will say I can reduce the cost for the OTT player. And number three, I will reduce your bandwidth cost over that. Right? So these are things which you can do right on the edge on the phone that you're using or on the DT that you're using. You can do much more. If you're taking a video conference call in your toilet, I can remove the background and make it look all professional. That doesn't mean you should take a video conference call in your toilet, but we can make it happen. Right? And we can take a low resource language like Pashto and transcribe it. We can look at a game which is happening live and recognize objects, people, and various other aspects which will make it even more interesting for the viewer. Yeah, so it is not just images and videos. We can make a difference in the wellness of all of us. So today, when we look at AI and health, we think about how can we use AI to improve the outcomes for today's modalities used in health, CT, MR, or an X-ray, or an ECG machine. How can we use AI to do better at those modalities? But that's not the way, or that's not the only way you can think about it. How about new ways of looking at it? How about if I look at you at a cellular level, I can tell you by looking at your cell, but in a very simple way, how much water is in the cell and how much water is out of the cell, and tell you whether you have chronic inflammation. And chronic inflammation is a precursor to all chronic diseases. And what are chronic diseases? Anything which is not infectious, right? So chronic diseases include things like heart attack, diabetes, arthritis, mental illness. So if I can tell you 5 years ahead that your lifestyle is not taking you in the right direction, won't it help? So that's what we're doing here. We're using bioimpedance, heart rate variability, and several other demographic kind of information like age, gender, menstrual cycle information. That's all one tap. And then we fuse it using neural networks along with our continuous measurements of bioimpedance and heart rate variability and tell you whether you're doing well or you need to take a look at your lifestyle, because chronic inflammation is an indication that you have something to pay attention to. Either you're not getting enough sunlight, as simple as that, or you're not getting enough exercise, you're not eating right, or it could be a variety of other problems. So this is the kind of data that we have taken, and that is the kind of outcomes which I discussed that we produce. So that's not an accident. That's a voice also that we have captured. So while we are capturing all this information, the picture of the eye, the picture of the tongue, the picture of the skin, why not also capture the voice, right? Because we do not know if it has any information that I can use. So I actually capture that voice and I'll put it through the neural network. If it can use it, if the voice has information on chronic inflammation, let it capture it. So that's what we're doing. So there is a lot which can be done with AI, and that's what I wanted to point out. The way I ask you to take a look at it, and you can build careers on this, you can build future of countries on this, and definitely you can think about the future of the world with this chart. What are the geopolitical trends? What are the consumer trends? Right? So geopolitical trends are things like climate change. We talked about it today. Terrorism was never a business opportunity, but today it is, to prevent terrorism. What are the kind of consumer trends? Women as decision makers on purchasing, that's a consumer trend. So wouldn't you think you want to think about new product lines? For example, I was talking to a young lady who was designing something for postpartum care. Nobody was worried about that until somebody started thinking about it. Right? So from trends to needs, so current needs and emerging needs. If today's need is to look at health from a standpoint of early diagnosis and cure, tomorrow's need is to predict and prevent. Right? So that is what AI will allow you to do. And only then, please think about the technology. Technology, AI is there, but it is not in isolation. So you have to think about it as an intersection of computing, materials, and biology. I tell all my engineering friends that engineering is great, but if you don't know biology, go and figure out. Because if you don't know biology, you're not going to be able to produce the kind of life-saving things or energy-saving things or various other things that we are looking at in the future. So here's now the place I want to land. Right? AI is going to change jobs. It's going to free up time, and there are choices that we can make. We can say that we take this time and make ourselves more busier, make ourselves more stressed, and then subject ourselves to all the suffering that we have discussed today. Or we can say that let us use these devices intelligently and take the time and look at what is the best use of it for me, for ourselves. Right? And one of the things I do believe is that for 2 million years, we have been hunter-gatherers. Our DNA has evolved to be a hunter-gatherer for 2 million years. Right? It's only for the past 10,000 years that we decided to be an agriculturalist. And it is only for the past 250 years that we have been industrialists. We are not ready for all this speed that we see around us. And so we can make a choice. And there are many bullets here that we can look at and make a difference to ourselves. But it is something that you have to think about and see how it works for you. Working 2 days a week is something you might not see it in your near future. I see it in my near future. And various other things that you can look at, connected to the planet, becoming a storyteller, becoming an artist. These are all things that people have spoken about today. With that, I'll stop and I'll say AI is here to change things, but you can use it to make the change positive. Thank you very much.